So I'm Dagi Fadel from Italy, and I will be moderating this session. I will start by introducing myself, and then I will introduce the session and all the speakers. So I am a contact lens designer, a pioneer of modern contact lens design, and a specialist in contact lenses for irregular cornea, scleral lenses, myopia control, and ortho K. I speak 5 languages: Arabic, French, English, Italian, and Greek. I'm internationally recognized as a key opinion leader who have several peer-reviewed publications in the area of specialty contact lenses, and I'm a speaker in national and international symposium. With Dr. Melissa Barnett, we are author of the Clinical Guide for Scleral Lens Success, and I authored the book of entitled Scleral Lens Complications, the Recognition, Etiology, and Management. I'm editor-in-chief of the Journal of Contact Lens Research and Science, and soon I will be moving to Canada for my new position at Center for Ocular Research and Education at the University of Waterloo. And my mission will be to advance course rapidly growing specialty contact lens initiative and education project. So this session, I love this session because it will treat all specialty practice, starting from myopia, how to manage myopia. We will be talking about special cases in scleral lenses, and then we will be talking about dry eye and the management and all the aspects of dry eye. So we will start with Dr. Tandin Minhui, who will be talking about the effect of atropine on pupillary dilation and on reduction of accommodation children with myopia. Dr. Hugh Tran is an MD and the head of myopia control clinic at Haiyan Eye Care in Ho Chi Minh City. He is working on myopia control related projects and translational research in the field of myopia. Also, he is currently an Asia Pacific Regional Ambassador of the International Myopia Institute with the aim to raise awareness about myopia and the role of myopia control in the eye care community in Vietnam. So please help me welcoming Dr. Huy Tran.
Thanks, Lady, for the great introduction. Thanks for the organization committee for having me today. It's my great pleasure to be here to speak in front of you at the Cake and Pie Expo 2 and to meet you all in person after 2 hard years of COVID with many travel restrictions. And today I would like to present about the effect of atropine on pupillary diameters and accommodative amplitude, which are mainly related to the 2 most common side effects with the use of atropine for myopia control. And then we are going to discuss about if the clinician should worry too much about it while using atropine eye drops for myopia management. That is one of the most critical questions that limit the uptake of using atropine for myopia management, especially in Vietnam. There are many recent evidence in the nowadays that support the fact that myopia control is imperative. And an estimate model recently developed by the BHVI team significantly suggests a difference of 2 diopters for over 10 years progression between no treatment and the treatment of myopia control with 30% of efficacy from a young kid at 6 years old with a baseline prescription at -1. And other recent evidence also suggests that with each diopter progressed, the risk of myopic maculopathy was estimated to increase by 67%. And with each diopter successfully controlled in childhood, the risk of myopic maculopathy was estimated to decrease by 40%. With that respect, the critical aim of myopia control treatment is to slow the progression of refractive error and the axial elongation. And therefore, reduce the risk of visual impairment later in their life. To date, atropine, a non-selective anti-muscarinic agent, is broadly an anti-muscarinic receptor agent, is the only pharmaceutical agent which consistently shown and consistently proven effective for myopia control and broadly adopted in many parts of the world. A recent network meta-analysis published in 2016 from Huang et al. Also proved that atropine control myopia progression greater than that observed with other optical strategies. And back to 15 years ago in 2007, a study in Taiwan also reported that up to 50% of ophthalmologists nationwide prescribed the atropine for the children with myopia. On this graph, we can observe that the red bars represent the efficacy for the myopia control treatment with respect to the progression of spherical equivalent, and the green bars are on the axial elongation. And from the study, the data was selected from the studies all around the world investigate myopia control treatment with various concentration of atropine. And there are two things that I would address to. The first is the effectiveness of atropine in controlling myopia progression is consistently shown. And second is the increasing number of studies in application of atropine in the recent years due to the clinical motivation, especially in the Asia Pacific region. However, the use of atropine eye drops for myopia control is not without issue. Despite no serious side effect to date, with the studies having the follow-up up to 10 years, photophobia and blurred near vision due to the pupillary dilation and decrease of accommodative amplitude, respectively, remain the major concern for the application of atropine in the myopia management. Another significant concern is the rebound of myopia that occurs on ceasing the treatment. Although previous meta-analysis have evaluated the efficacy of various concentration of atropine on axial elongation and on the progression of refractive error, its effect on pupillary diameters and decrease of accommodative amplitude, which can negatively affect the treatment compliance and therefore limit their use in the clinical practice, has not been considered so far. Therefore, I conduct a meta-analysis in which I evaluate all the concentration investigated so far, both for side effect on pupillary dilation and on reduction of accommodative amplitude, as well as the efficacy in myopia control, with the aim of recommending the concentration of atropine eye drops with tolerable side effect. Following the PRISMA guideline, I search all the eligible electronic medical database from 1980 to 2020. And based on inclusion and exclusion criteria, a total of 13 eligible studies was finally selected to the meta-analysis. And the meta-analysis include data of nearly 3,000 participants aged between 4 to 16 years old who were investigated for the use of 9 different concentration from 0.01 to 1% of concentration, including 0.01, 0.02, 0.025, 0.05, 0.1, 0.125, 0.25, 0.5, and 1% of concentration. Regarding the amplitude of accommodation, all concentration excepting 0.01% atropine result in the reduction of accommodative amplitude, with the mean change at minus 4.67 diopter and 95% confidence of interval range between minus 7.44 to minus 1.89 diopters. Observing the forest plot, the authors also found a significant greater reduction in the groups at 0.1% and above than that observed in the groups less than 0.1%. Interestingly, similar pattern was also found with respect to the increasing of pupillary diameters, we can see that there's a significant difference between the groups at 0.1% and above and less than 0.1%. Together, all concentration of atropine dilate the pupil with the mean change at 1.33 millimeters and 95% confidence of interval range between 0.57 to 2.09 millimeters. Plotting the weight data together with various concentration for the change in accommodative amplitude and pupil size, we found a nonlinear dose dependent effect with a steep change but small, with the concentration less than 0.1% and the change plateau but high for the concentration at 0.1% and above. In fact, only small percent of participants was report of photophobia and difficulties at near work, with many study using the concentration at less than 0.1%. Interestingly, similar patterns was also observed in considering the rebound effect over 1 year cessation of atropine eye drops in ATOM 1 and ATOM 2 conducted by the Singaporean team. Looking to this table, indeed at the concentration less than 0.1%, the mean change in pupillary diameters and accommodative amplitude was 0.7 millimeters and minus 1.6 diopter respectively. Whereas at the concentration of 0.1% and above, it increased to 3.2 millimeters and minus 10.7 diopter respectively. This different for the change in pupillary diameters and accommodative amplitude between the two subgroups, less than 0.1% and at 0.1% and above, were statistically significant. So moving up to the efficacy, this table compared the efficacy between two subgroups and they indicate a statistically significant difference between two subgroups, less than 0.1 and at 0.1% and above, in terms of controlling axial elongation. Regarding the progression of spherical equivalent, although the difference was not statistically significant, but the difference of annual progression of 0.38 diopter per year can be considered clinically relevant. Despite several limitations, this meta-analysis indicates a non-linear dose-dependent correlation between concentration investigated so far of atropine and the side effect, as well as the efficacy of atropine would suggest cutoff point at 0.1% of concentration. At concentration less than 0.1%, the effect on pupillary size and accommodative amplitude was small, with insignificant variation between various concentrations. Although higher concentration of atropine at 0.1% and above are able to significantly slow the ocular elongation, they are accompanied by larger increase of pupillary diameters and greater reduction of accommodative amplitude that can reduce the treatment compliance and that therefore limit their use in the clinical practice. More work needs to be warranted to confirm the optimal low concentration atropine with highest efficacy possible, along with tolerable side effect. However, in clinical practice, the small increase of pupil size and the loss of a small amount of accommodative amplitude with the use of atropine less than 0.1% of concentration are unlikely to result in any significant symptom as children tend to have a large reserve of compensation. Indeed, recent data from reports of LAM in Hong Kong also illustrate and support that idea. Although LAM study, a well-conducted randomized controlled trial for the use of atropine 0.01, 0.025, 0.05, report a dose-dependent efficacy and side effect of myopia control treatment. This table showed that there was no such a higher need of photochromatic glasses nor higher need of progressive glasses between groups of using 0.05, 0.025 versus 0.01 or placebo. Moreover, despite statistically significant reduction of accommodative amplitude, especially in the groups using 0.025 and 0.05, LAM result report negligible reduction of near visual acuity in all groups. And the near visual acuity in all groups remain functionally good enough for the kids for all their schoolwork and for their near activities. That point also aligned with only a small number of the kids in all groups of the LAMP study did ask for the progressive glasses. In summary, low concentration atropine mostly used to date with the concentration at 0.01, 0.02, and 0.05 is the key pharmaceutical myopia control intervention. The side effect, including pupillary dilation and reduction of accommodative amplitude with low concentration atropine might be considered tolerable, especially with the concentration less than 0.1%. Therefore, with the need of efficient myopia control treatment, the rapid uptake for the use of low concentration atropine in the clinical practice is highly recommended. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Dr. Hu Chan. So now it's time for Dr. Rajiv Prasad. Dr. Rajiv Prasad, senior clinical optometrist currently based in Delhi with clinical practices in Bihar and Noida. Dr. Prasad was trained in Japan and the United States in eye screening for special population. He has presented as an invited speaker to several national and international forums in optometry. Dr. Prasad is the only Indian optometrist who received the honor of the most prestigious Optometrist of the Year award for 2 years, 2018 and 2020. Currently, Dr. Prasad is the Secretary General of the Indian Optometry Association and Vice President of the Asia Pacific Council of Optometry. He also serves as Board of Director of the World Council of Optometry and is a member of the Public Health Committee. Dr. Prasad will be talking about myopia, bird's view on growing global pandemic. Welcome.
Good morning, everyone. So these days we have started talking about myopia all over. So I'll just take you to a little tour what it is and why myopia matters to everybody. So blindness is enveloping. It's beyond belief to step outside and see so little. Just a milky haze indoors us, so smoothing dark. It means that you can't shed a mood of loneliness with a brisk walk down the street because you might trip, fall and break something. Now you'll see a passing friend, the sight of whom could be cherry as an actual conversation. Sights like sounds randomly evoke a surge of memories, ordinarily inaccessible, that lighting and brightening the day. Human nature is stripped with ambitious, and you need to see them, but like a prisoner, I'm hooked. So why myopia matters these days? Let us talk about the prevalence. So myopia has increasingly prevalent around the world recent decades. I mean, it is no more just as a refractive error earlier, you know, during our college days we used to talk about. It's more beyond that. How this is affecting? So it's definitely, it has become a growing public health concern. Many authors has reported the prevalence of myopia is going high, particularly concerned in Asian countries. Degree of myopia is also increasing. Myopia increase risk of many ocular pathologies like glaucoma, retinal hole, tears, retinal and detachments, cataract, myopic macular degeneration, and so on. So this has actually motivated for more of research. As you can see here, in 2000, the low myopes were 77.1%, where it has, by 2050, it is expected that low down to 50.2, and definitely approaching 10% of the world population by 2050. So myopia consequences of rising prevalence has definitely uncorrected refractive error will increase, blindness, vision impairment will increase, cataract, glaucoma, need of refractive and specialist service will be increased, and burden cost of glasses, specialist needs, social burden with all. You can see here, in specifically this particular area, I mean East Asia, Asia Pacific, and Southeast Asia, the percentage is very high. And definitely that is what WHO says, that by 2050, definitely it is increasing. And the number of high myopes are more, which is 9.8%. So why this is increasing? Let us talk about the contributing factor. So if neither of the parents is low myope, neither of the parents are myope, the risk is really less. If it is one of the parent is myope, the percent is definitely three times higher. The risk is three times higher. And if both the parents are myope, chances is like six times. So genetics definitely matter. As you can see here in the picture, if one of the parent is affected, so definitely chances of getting, you know, two offsprings confirm myopia. Whereas if both are recessive, definitely one is confirmed myopic and two is carrier. So definitely genetics, as we know, it's playing a big role, and there are several studies which has proven this. Peripheral hyperopia, routine correction constantly moves image behind the retina, that is what we know, which may continually signal the eye to grow. Another factor, environment, sunlight, vitamin D, dopamine level, time spent outdoors are another few factors. These days, post-COVID, we all have seen the increase of, you know, screen time, and that has actually pushed the things to grow further. So what does myopia control means? I mean, I differed with this word. Myopia control really cannot be done. It is actually all about myopia management, how you are managing it. You cannot stop the growth of myopia, right? So what does myopia control mean? Is it no change in myopia or a reduction in the amount of myopia? To many parents, patients, and practitioners, it means no change in myopia, which is unfortunately not the real picture. So axial length, I mean, hundreds of thousands of studies which has proven that axial length is a great factor. So research dedicated to myopia control must be focused on patients with axial myopia. Patients with refractive myopia can be excluded. Valid research focused on proving axial elongation as an inclusion criteria. So definitely the precision of, you know, growing axial length matters to everybody. And why this is important? Definitely there is 4 to 15 times increase chances of getting a retinal detachment. You have another glaucoma issues, cataract, myopic maculopathy. So myopia limiting its burden, management mechanism are either you can delay or prevent or control the progression. And there are various options which are available. Lifestyle modification, corneal reshaping, multifocal contact lenses, medicated eye drops like atropine and multifocal spectacles. So there are a few studies which has also confirmed that time spent outdoors has a significant, you know, results in decreasing the myopia. So these are some of the studies which was done. So time spent outdoors appears to be an influential factor, especially in preventing myopia onset. However, its role in slowing myopia progression, especially once condition is well established, remains unclear. The strategy to be implemented is also still unclear. Is it simply cumulative, times outdoors, or numbers, duration of activities, or others? How much time outdoors? Like usually, it has been told that 10 hours per week appears to be a threshold. That is like almost like 1.5 to 2 hours a day. So we also need smarter way to engage children, parents, schools, and community. This we have discussed, like the options which are available for myopia management. There are other options which are also available, like, you know, ophthalmic lenses like Stellest or MyoSmart. These are a couple of those lenses which are there. And the future, yes, we are moving towards artificial intelligence. On its imperative that potential approach to address myopia should be firstly its complication and early detection and treatment. That is what we all focus on. However, current healthcare system may not be able to cope up with the growing burden, and digital technology solution such as artificial intelligence has emerged a potential adjunct to myopia management. AI approaches might be effective for risk stratification and its individuals at higher risk of vision loss. However, unresolved challenges for artificial intelligence, medical studies remain, including paucity of transparency, audibility, and traceability. The few domains which are really working is machine learning, deep learning, genetics, natural language processing, NLP. So applications of artificial intelligence in genomics and NLP appears to be the next stage. Machine learning has demonstrated to be useful adjunct of myopia prediction, and biometry for cataract surgery is highly myopic individual. So what's next? So the future has been built as a key component of the four industrial resolution. Definitely we are moving towards virtual reality. So a virtual reality device is an immersive medium that uses a head-mounted display. Virtual reality creates the sensation of being entirely transported into virtual three-dimensional world, which can provide a far more experience compared to other video formats. Many studies have reported that a significant proportion of VR devices users experience a highly aversive sense of discomfort, disorientation, nausea, and motion sickness, visual asthenopia, visual discomfort, and fatigue as well. So early identification of high-risk individuals and unhindered access to appropriate healthcare will be critical in stemming the myopia tide. The global attention towards myopia has led to be renewed focus on prediction, prevention, and early control, as well as diagnostic accuracy. Currently, we are witnessing the growing shift to artificial intelligence from theoretical ideations to practical applications in healthcare. Ophthalmology has emerged as one of the focal point of AI research. Currently, AI platforms are highly successful in screening for diabetic retinopathy, ARMD, and glaucoma. The question rises, like virtual reality tolerance in the kids. There haven't been any longitudinal study to investigate virtual reality and myopia, its effect on visual development of children. At this stage, only short-term studies on visual function effects in children and on oculomotor and choroidal thickness changes in young adults have been published, which together can be extrapolated to theories about how virtual reality could influence myopia. So the take-home message goes is there is no firm consequences on when myopia stops progression. Currently, artificial intelligence research is mainly focused on disease classification and prediction of myopia. Through greater collaborative research, we envision AI will play an increasingly critical role in big data analysis by aggregating a greater variety of parameters, including genomes and environmental factors. This may enable the development of generalizable adjunctive deep learning system that could help realize predictive and individualized precision medicine for myopic patients. Most studies concluded future studies and machine learning algorithm development will focus on validation of newer models with respect to community-based population and multi-ethnic groups, researchers concluded. So these are a few references which I have taken, so thank you so much.
Thank you, Dr. Sassan, for the amazing presentation. So now it's time for my presentation, and we will do a little break for myopia control. We'll be talking about scleral lenses, special cases in scleral lenses. So the first case about scleral lenses will be endothelial cell density. So why low cell density is a limit? Here it's an article that I wrote a few years ago about potential contraindication about sclerolenses. There is no true contraindications for sclerolenses. Every case is individual and should be taken as an individual case. So the reduction of cell density in our practice of sclerolens is important because we are dealing with patients with keratoplasty, and we know that patients with keratoplasty, after keratoplasty, the cell density loss will be ranging between 39 and 71%. 71% of loss of the endothelial cell. And patients undergone keratoplasty from 15 to 31% will develop astigmatism, irregular astigmatism up to 5 diopters. These patients will not have any success with soft contact lenses or corneal lenses. They need sclerolenses, they need to function. So how to do with these lenses? Here, several studies have shown that fitting sclerolenses in patients with transplant had some success. Only 6% of eyes has demonstrated periodic episodes, not constant periods of corneal edema. And Severinsky suggested that to use hypertonic saline when edema occurs and to accelerate the recovery of the edema. And if edema persists, just use the hypertonic saline during sclerolens wear into the fluid reservoir. This will help. So here is my case from Spain. I have several cases from around the world, and this was from Spain. I was surprised from having a patient from Spain because I know very good practitioners in Spain. So I was surprised in having her. What is her case? So she knows already that she has a complex case. So the subject of her email indeed is sclerolens. So she knew that she wanted sclerolenses and she wanted them for her complex case. So she was desperate because she undergone keratoplasty, and her keratoplasty is old, 20 years old graft. And we know that the grafts don't last forever. They need to be redone after 20 or 30 years. So she is very near to the next graft. And if we create edema in these cases, we will accelerate the second graft. She was desperate because in Spain, no one wanted to fit her with sclerolenses. Why? Because she had an old graft, so they didn't want to take the risk in fitting her. And she had also the endothelial cell very low. It was about 730 cells per milliliter squares. So I decided to fit her because you cannot know, you cannot prevent edema. You cannot say that this patient will have edema, will have corneal edema. I had some cases with 500 cells per millimeter squared. They didn't develop edema. And I have cases with 1,000 cells per millimeter squared. They developed edema. So how to know if this patient will develop edema? Just fit them with sclerolenses and monitor their corneal response. That's the only way how to understand if they will be developing edema. But of course, you need to tell them. You need to be honest with them and let them aware about the risk they are having and sign an informed consent. That's exactly what I did. So I took also the pachymetry of this patient to understand how this corneal pachymetry, the thickness of the cornea, will change after sclerolens wear. What I did in this case is to fit her with customized lenses. Why customized? So I designed all my sclerolenses ortho K lenses and corneal lenses. In this case, it was very important to have a very well-designed lens because edema is not created because of the lack of oxygen from the air, but also a bad fitting of scleral lens will create edema. Conjunctival compression, limbal congestion, lens adhesion, these all complications will create edema. I didn't want edema. So I decided to choose a material with a high decay, the highest decay available in the market actually. I added two fenestrations to allow more oxygen supply to the cornea through the holes, but these holes also will allow a tear exchange as well. The tears coming into the fluid reservoir will provide fresh oxygen as well. The volt was reduced at the maximum. Here you can see that the volt and her visual acuity was amazing. But I didn't care about her visual acuity. My concerns were her cornea response. So we started with 4 hours per day. And after 4 days, she developed only less than 1%. And it was amazing. So at this point, we increased the wearing time to 7 hours per day. She went back to Spain. I contacted an optometrist in Spain who followed her closely. And then at the three-month follow-up, she came to Italy, and I did the follow-up after 3 months. 1 week before her coming in Italy, she called me, and she was very excited because she finally found a job. She was depressed before applying scleral lenses, and now with scleral lenses, she found a job. So she needed to wear the scleral lenses for more than 7 hours per day. And she asked me, can I wear them for 9 hours per day? I was a little bit concerned, but I knew that she would do that. However, so I told her, okay, wear your lenses for 9 hours per day, and we will see how your cornea will react. So here you can see the follow-up after 3 months, the volt very, very reduced. You can maybe see that the lens is touching in the upper cornea, but it's not touching, it's very close to the cornea. And here you can see the fenestration in the upper area of the limbal area. So the oxygen supply was ensured. And after 9 hours, she still had less than 1% of edema. It was amazing. I was very happy. She wasn't happy because she wanted her lenses for more than 9 hours per day. Why? Why to stress your cornea? But she told me that, okay, now I am driving again my car. So before, she had her father driving her to the work because she couldn't see. Now she is driving again. So you can see how scleral lenses change the patients, not only the patient's life, the life of all the families surrounding these patients. So, okay, I told her, wear your lenses for me now for 12 hours per day, and let's see how your cornea will react. So she wore them for 12 hours per day. The edema increased, but still less than 1%. This was amazing. So you cannot prevent edema. You can prevent edema, but you cannot say that patient will develop edema unless you fit them with scleral lenses and you will see. So she was incredibly happy because she finally can see, but she finally had her life back. So I have a question that frequently I'm asked. So these holes in the lenses, will they allow the fluid reservoir go away from the lenses? So I did this video with the holes, and you can see how the saline did not go away because these holes are very, very small. And how to do these holes? So I started customizing my lenses because I wanted special lenses, and the industry, the labs in Italy didn't have these designs. And also I learned how to do notches and fenestrations. So here it's a video of a notch. You have to mark where you want the notch and where you want the fenestration while the lens is applied on the eye. Then with the drill bites, you can do that. Here I'm rounding the edges of the notch, and you need to polish them. So how to polish a thinner bite, and you cover it with the microfiber tissue and some polish solution, and you go and polish them. It's very important to polish them, otherwise they will hurt the pinguecula. Here is the fenestration, similar thing. So a bite of 0.3, 0.5 millimeter maximum, and you do the hole. Also, you need to round the edges of the hole as well. So it's very simple to do them. So here I'm rounding the hole, and very, very easy to do them. Here you can see how the notch is polished. I use simple tools, and we did these this training in the workshops that I do worldwide. I go worldwide with my project and teaching how to fix clear lenses, how to customize clear lenses, and how to do these small modification of the lens. So here, practitioner is doing a notch of fenestration, and this is the flower lens that we created with our tools during that workshop. So I think it will be, okay, so what to do when you have patients with low cell density? Documentation and photodocumentation is very important before the fitting to understand how that cornea is reacting, and it's important to prevent edema, high GK, thin lens, thin vault, and tear exchange is very important. The fitting also is important, so please be aware that the fitting may create edema as well. And consider fenestrations and tear exchange is very important. Okay, the second case is about a very thin cornea. So this is a very special case for me. She is a 19 years old from Germany. She was desperate, she was depressed, very depressed when she came to me. And she had, because she was considered a disabled patient, person. So here you can understand why she was desperate and depressed. She had very low vision. So she was diagnosed with an autoimmune condition. Here you can see her PMD topography, and her vision was decreased importantly only in 2021. And she couldn't work, she couldn't go outside. She was very related and dependent on her mother. So she had the PMD plus thin cornea. I don't know if you can see here the thinnest location, 93 microns. You know what is 93 microns? It's nothing. So she didn't have only PMD, she didn't have only thin cornea, but she had haze, she had glare in the pupil area, Gauss vessels, neovascularization. So I didn't want edema neither in this case. What to do in these cases? Also customized lenses, no conjunctival pressure, limbal congestion. I don't want that. I don't want adhesion of the lens on the eye. So customized lenses as well. And she was extremely happy. She was back to her normal life. She started a new job. So she is a teacher in the school, but she is considering going to the university. So she has in life, she has a present, but she is looking to her future. And she applied for driving license, and she is driving now. Amazing. So how these lenses change our patient's life, and when they are happy, we are definitely happy. Other special cases are scleral lenses with telescopes. I don't know if you ever heard about scleral lenses with telescope. Here, a telescope for low vision. Telescope, it was included in the optic zone of the lens. The optical ray trace through one pair is in the red, and the 2.8 pair is in the blue. Other case is to deal with binocular vision. So this is a case in Argentina. He didn't come to me, but I assisted a practitioner in Argentina to design these lenses for him. So he had a horizontal diplopia of 10 prismatic diopters. Amazing, very huge diplopia. So we couldn't put 10 prismatic diopters in one lens. We divided these in two lenses. So we did the we included the prism in the optic session zone and the optic zone in both lenses, and that patient was very happy. He was an athlete, and we stabilized the lens with toric haptic, but also with double slab off, because these prism needed to be very stable to maintain the horizontal base, okay? So other special cases are ocular surface diseases. Why they are special? Because in these cases, you will cover the ocular surface, not only the cornea, but also the conjunctiva. So scleral lens will protect this area of the ocular surface, but they will have important problems, very frustrating for you and for them. Two main problems: ocular, the surface of the lens will be very poor with wetting. So you will have poor wetability in these cases. And wetability, you all know that it will compromise vision, decrease comfort, decrease wetting time, and it will increase the chair time because patients will be frustrating and asking you to resolve this problem. The other problems is midday fogging. They will develop debris into the fluid reservoir. So how to do when they have poor wetability? You can suggest them just to avoid removing the lens during the day and clean it, just suggest them to use a cotton swab or a plunger for application of the lens with the hole. Wet these devices with some wetting solution and they need to clean it while the lens is applied on the eye. How to do when they have midday fogging? Midday fogging is when they develop debris into the fluid reservoir, okay? So here you can also suggest them, so talking about still about wetability, here is a poor wetable lens, and the same lens was sent to the lab to put Hydrapec. I don't know if you have Hydrapec here in Vietnam, but Hydrapec is very useful for to resolve poor wetable lenses. Here, the midday fogging, what to do in these cases? Midday fogging generally is adjusted by the fitting, but sometimes it's very frustrating. And even if you have a very well-aligned lens on the conjunctiva, you will still have midday fogging. So what to do? Just put the saline in the edge of the lens, flush the saline inside, and this technique will renew all the fluid reservoir behind the lens. Here, fluorescein was put to show how this technique will renew all the fluid reservoir. Again, in the workshops that I do worldwide, practitioners try this technique. Patients need to do that by themselves. You don't have to do them to do it for them. They have to do it by themselves. And here you can see how this practitioner is renewing the fluid reservoir. In South Africa also, this practitioner tried to have the renewal with this technique, but she wasn't happy to do only this technique to renew the fluid reservoir, but she tried to remove an air bubble behind the lens. So she created an air bubble and she used this technique to remove them, and she did it. Amazing. So as a conclusion, several good reasons to have technology. Technology is not only important for complex cases, but also for simple cases. You don't need technology to design a very good aligned lens on the eye. Good fitting, but technology is very important for to monitor the corneal health. We need to maintain corneal health and how to do it without technology. When you are providing this customized lens, you are providing also customized care. So this is the difference between you and other people providing only lenses. Thank you. Be switching to our virtual speakers. So we had three in-person speakers, and we'll be in connection with our virtual speakers. So back to myopia control now. We will be talking about the business of myopia control, and who better than Dr. Alan Glasier talking about this subject. So Dr. Alan Glasier is the founder and visionary behind ODs on Facebook, the eye care industry's largest and most highly engaged eye care organization online or offline, with over 45,000 members. He is the founder of Shady Grove Eye and Vision Care in Rockville, Maryland, and the partner business development executive in Kepler Vision. In 2011 and 2012, Vision Monday Org has selected Dr. Glasier as one of the most influential optometrists in the United States. In 2021, he was number two on Newsweek's list of America's best eye doctors. In the same year, he was presented with the American Optometry Association Social Media Advocacy Award. So Dr. Glasier is the inventor on seven issued patents in computer science and ophthalmology. He has been interviewed by CNN, NBC, CBS, Entrepreneur Magazine, INC Magazine, Blog Talk Radio, and Network Solutions. So welcome to Dr. Alan Glasier.
Thank you so much for that kind welcome. So happy to be with you all tonight. Sorry I couldn't be there in person. That was supposed to happen, but that's another story for another time. Can you see my screen? Somebody. Okay. Well, we're here to talk about the business of myopia control. And what I want you to think about through this whole talk is that the business behind correcting myopia, which is now involves myopia control, is called optometry. So it's really the business of optometry we're talking about. There's before modern myopia control developed, we all knew how to care for and how to offer options and sell things and run our businesses around myopia. And what was optometry without myopia? You know, you can't run a practice on hyperopia and presbyopia alone. And as the standard of care.
Dr. Glazier, sorry to interrupt, but we cannot see your slides yet. Can you
please share? Okay. Oh, got it. Okay. Sorry about that. So I hit share screen. Can you see my screen now?
Yes, we can see it now.
Okay, I'm sorry.
Yeah, thank you.
Could you hear me so I can kind of just skip past that? All right. So as the standard of care evolves, the business of myopia control is becoming the business of myopia care, which is something we're all intimately familiar with. So it's not some weird, strange thing. There's things we have to learn, but there are no professionals on the planet more qualified to learn them and execute them in business than we are. The difference is there's new terminology, there's new concepts. And the biggest thing about the business of myopia control is the time that it takes to get what you're doing across to the parents, because they all grew up in an era where they weren't aware of this. All the parents who are watching their child's exam are thinking, gosh, you know, doctor's going to tell me the prescription changed and we're going to get them new glasses just like they did when I was a kid. Well, now the paradigm has shifted, and getting that across is not only difficult, but it's time consuming. And there's also some trust issues in there, especially with patients who don't know you from before. Now, that's a whole nother lecture on talking to parents about myopia control. But let's move over and talk more about other aspects of the business, like positioning a product. And anyone who has a business knows what I mean when I say positioning a product. In optometry, it's very important to specialize. And the reason is because when you specialize, you differentiate yourself in the marketplace. When you differentiate yourself, you have an advantage over others that are competing with you in that marketplace. That advantage equals a gain in the marketplace. So specialization equals a gain in the marketplace. And the first thing you want to do when you're positioning yourself is educate parents on what you're doing and what position you have in the market now that this is out there. And probably 80 to 90% of your colleagues in the area don't know how to do it or don't know about it or don't implement it. So the information on myopia control is poorly disseminated to the public at this point. So make sure you take the time to discuss this new paradigm with every parent, even if you're not going to push them into their child into myopia control at this point. Even if they're an emerging myope and you want to watch them, let them know about it ahead of time. That way, when they come to that decision-making time, it'll be much easier to talk to those parents and get them involved. And patients talk and they refer. So even if it's not that parent, if they know about it, they're going to talk around the card table to their friends and tell them about this new myopia control thing, especially if the child's vision comes up as a topic there. Now, we're all familiar with in-office marketing. In our office, this is an old version. We have a handout, a pamphlet that we give to every parent to read after we talk about it, so that, you know, we give them a thorough intro to the topic and this, and say, go home and read it. If you have any questions, reach out, set up a follow-up, or we can talk about it next year. And that way they have something, and they'll see it repeatedly, because marketing takes repeated exposures to get somebody to buy into something. In-office marketing also includes the standard traditional types of marketing, like posters, looping videos in the waiting area, email blast using customer communication softwares. Get creative. Like in China, they, in Ortho K clinics, I believe, and now I'm talking to a group of Chinese doctors out there. Some Ortho K clinics have beds in the waiting room, futuristic looking beds in domes, where they'll send patients out to try their Ortho K lenses on and lay there. And then patients will have questions about, ooh, what are they doing? What's going on there? And that may happen in other countries too. I just know that happened in a clinic in China at least once. Develop a video, feature patients who are willing to, and will sign a release on YouTube talking about their experience doing myopia control as part of your marketing as well. And you can refer your patients not only with that pamphlet, but refer them to that YouTube video so they can access it as they'd like in a more modern way. The next most important thing is educating your staff on myopia control. Your receptionists, your ophthalmic techs, they should be fluent in how they discuss the subject with parents, and they should all know, have the same information when they share it, because that's the encounter, that's the entrance point into the exam. And if the patient hears about it from the receptionist or on the phone when they call, then they hear about it from the ophthalmic tech, and then they hear about it from you, they're already somewhat familiar with it. It's not that strange. It's not right out of left field, and they're more likely to consider it. Some of the ways we tell our staff to talk to parents, or how we talk to parents when we're kind of dumbing this down for the average patient, is we talk about hemiretinal form deprivation and the role that plays, and how nearsightedness, you know, doing things up close can stimulate that because of that hemiretinal form deprivation. And I talk about a study that was done many, many years ago where chickens had one eye where their peripheral vision was deprived with a quarter of a ping pong ball, and the other eye was left open, and the eye with the hemiretinal deprivation became much more myopic. So we talk about that. We talk about how that transfers into the child's behaviors at home, such as this: a child who has long hair and reads and leans forward, and while they're looking up close, they're also depriving their peripheral vision because of that long hair. And I'm not just jealous because I don't have hair, but that's a real thing. We talk about screen working distance. Make sure that it's far enough away. The further, the better. We talk about handheld digital devices or books, how the elbows should never be in an acute angle, or even at a right angle is too close. We encourage the parents to encourage the children to hold their work out at an obtuse angle. And we explain that myopia is a disease, and we talk about the problems that can develop with myopes, the higher risk for retinal detachment, glaucoma, age-related eye disease, and things like that. So getting that across is very impactful. So after educating parents, then you can also add to your list getting out into the community. In our area, there is a highly Asian area, highly Chinese, and Chinese families have Sunday schools where the children are attending Chinese cultural Sunday school, and the parents are sitting in a room talking and socializing until the children are done. And they bring in speakers, and we've really boosted our myopia control practice by going in and speaking about myopia control in some of these Chinese Sunday schools. We go to the primary school nurses, and when we can, because there's some regulations about this, but we leave cards, we leave pamphlets, we talk to them about if they see children who are having some social difficulties and wearing really strong glasses, that this might be able something that can help them. And we participate in health fairs as well. We also incentivize patients for referrals. It's legal where we are. We will give $100 to a parent of a myopia control patient to their account. And if they send 10 people, pays for half of their myopia control for the whole year. So that's a very useful way if you're able to do it. And it adds up to a lot of revenue for your practice. And then increasing public awareness and marketing yourself online, which is a really, really critical thing nowadays. You want to work on getting your position when people search for the products and services you hope to be found for in Google high, so that you're on the first page or maybe in the first position, either in the organic listings or in that little three pack that comes up when people search locally. And in order to get there, you have to be engaged in social media, and you have to be creating content around the topic of eye care, mostly around myopia and myopia control. And content creation is key to having a robust marketing effort online that local people can find and find out about what you do. Now, what is content? Well, it's nothing fancy. Here's the definition right here: the information and experiences directed towards an end user or audience. What people derive value from when they read online. When you write a blog for your practice, you're giving away some of your expertise, and that is the content in that case. And content also can be video content. It can be pictures. It can be just simply talking to people in medical, talking with the public in social media, blogging, tweeting, podcasting. All those things are content, and producing content matters for your marketing efforts, because when patients search online for the products and services you hope to be found for, they're typing in words like myopia, myopia control. That's a phrase. So key phrases are when you have more than one word, and then long-tailed key phrases now: how do I stop my child's vision from changing? And people actually search those exact words. If you've created content that those words are in, it's going to elevate that content when those people search those terms. So it's imperative to produce then publish content on your business real estate, keywords, key phrases, think up anything and everything that a parent might type in there. And if your blog has that exact phrase, you'll be a match before the practice down the street. Myopia control, when it comes to pricing, remember, this is a premium service. Remember how much your education costs. Remember that you're out there making a living and providing a very valuable healthcare service. But at the same time, charge what your training and expertise are worth. Also, within what the local market will bear. What I charge in my market is going to be different than what someone else is able to charge as well. So determine what your guarantees, your warranties, your replacements will be like. Are you going to structure your fees as global fees, meaning you do everything under one fee, or do you charge for services and then lenses? How are you going to do that? What works for you? And what's a way that's going to make you be able to explain that to your patients so that they're going to buy in? And whatever you do, do not discount. This is something that is a problem in optometry, that we often don't charge what we think what we're worth. And if we start doing that, then we're lowering the value in the services we provide. And the perception is that the service is valued lower as well. So we do an intense informed consent around it. And I'm not going to read this to you. I'll just leave it up here for a second while I talk about it. But the first thing, generally, we talk about how what we're doing and how this is certain keywords in there, like temporarily reducing or eliminating, and patients sign off on this, because if they come back and say, hey, you said this is going to be permanent, we have to explain to them what its limitations are and be ethical and about that. In candidacy, this talks about what the limitations might look like and why we may or may not have success. And this is kind of how we do that. We talk about you must sleep in them for at least 8 hours, or we can't guarantee any outcomes. So that, you know, they all come back and tell you that Ortho-K is not working. And well, how much sleep is your kid getting? It's 6 hours. Well, hello, you know, we talked about that. And then we list all the potential complications in there and discuss them up front before we ever start the process, and have them sign off knowing that these might be complications, and while rare, how we handle them as well. We also put in there what we expect from them in terms of care, and that reduces any risks they have of having infections and complications, and then what to do if they do have a complication. And we talk about what it is most of the time, but don't panic, just don't wait, come in and see us. And in the entire 30 years I've been doing Ortho-K, I've only seen one infectious keratitis from it. And that was a really interesting situation, which happened from outside of the country and could have been prevented as well. Then we have them sign this where I understand the risks. I understand that it's temporary. And I understand that the fees are refundable in full if we don't deliver on what we promised. And because I don't want to give bad profits or something in business that often people choose, like late fees for exam or no-show fees. And, you know, that's nickel and dime value. You really want to earn your money based on things you do that drive value for people. And if you don't, you know, you put your time and effort into it, but if it's something different like this, we make a guarantee that we'll give that money back. But again, I can't remember the last time we haven't delivered on that. And that was like a 2-hour lecture in 13 minutes. I'm under the wire. So I'll pass my time off to the other speakers. And again, thank you so much for having me here. I really appreciate it. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Glaser. Now it's time for Dr. Elise Brisco. She is the founder of Nearsight, a new vision wellness company that is revolutionizing solutions to keep people comfortable and productive on their device in our digital culture. Yeah, Dr. Brisco has dedicated her career to helping others through her multidisciplinary wellness group and integrative optometric and homeopathic practice. She has written many articles, been a key opinion leader, and has presented lectures extensively. She continues her mission to educate and motivate others to live their life best as a health, beauty, and fitness influencer. Dr. Brisco is a doctor turned model and pageant queen. She is a reigning Miss Women California, United States, and a runway and published model. Her platform is Healthy Living for Healthy Aging. So please help me welcoming Dr. Elise Brisco.
Thank you so much. Xin chào quý vị, tôi tên là bác sĩ Elise Brisco. Tôi rất mừng đến đây hôm nay nói chuyện với quý vị. Tôi là người Việt Nam mà sinh đã ở Chicago, USA. Cho nên xin phép nói chuyện bằng tiếng Anh. So I hope you understood my Vietnamese, and my talk today is called Beauty and the Dry Eye Beast. And the reason I'm talking about this is as I'm an optometrist, like all of you, but I've crossed over into the other world. I'm now a fashion model and swimwear model. I am the reigning, can't see it, but I'm the reigning Miss California. And I'm gonna be representing California in the Miss United States pageant in Memphis this October. I'm hoping to be the first Vietnamese optometrist to be receive the national crown as Miss Woman United States. I've been an integrative optometrist for the last 34 years, went back to school to become a certified clinical homeopath. So I take a very holistic approach to healthcare and vision care. I am also the founder and CEO of Nearsight, which is a vision wellness company, a startup, and we develop innovative solutions to vision problems that result from aging, as well as our heavy dependence on technology. So why am I talking about beauty? Now that I'm in the other world and still having all the experience, clinical experience as an optometrist, as I'm really realizing people value beauty even more than their health, and they show it with their pocketbooks. In the United States, people spend around $600 a year on medical. Just on skincare products and makeup alone, they spend $4,000. And that's not even including medical procedures like Botox or injections and things like that. This is how, if you want to be a good doctor, you have to address and connect their health problem or vision problem to a beauty problem. And that's how you get them to be compliant. The global makeup market, just makeup, is $85 billion. And we Asians love to look good. They say the Asian 15, that we look 15 years younger than our Caucasian counterparts. But that's because we take good care of ourselves. So we are 50% of the beauty market. So each treatment that I recommend to a patient, I emphasize the cosmetic benefits of it. And the reason we're talking about beauty and the dry eye beast is dry eyes can be ugly. There's a lot of aesthetics and how you look that can result from having dry eyes. So what I let patients know is that without health, you can't have true beauty. You know, they wear beautiful clothes and makeup, but you can't cover up an unhealthy person. So I talk about self-care and in-office care and everything I relate back to beauty. The thing of it is, let me show a couple of things here, is here are some of the results of dry eyes that are downright ugly. I have patients still texting me saying, hey, Dr. Brisco, my lashes are falling out, or my eyelids are puffy and red and crusty. And that's a result of not taking care of themselves, or with age, there's a higher percentage of us who have dry eyes. And even makeup, things that are supposed to make us look beautiful can make us look ugly, like makeup staining in the eye or makeup with harsh ingredients and carcinogenics in there too. So I start off by recommending clean makeup. And there's one brand I really love that only uses clear makeup because it's clean ingredients, because it is developed by a female ophthalmologist. So let's start off with the effective in-office treatments then that can achieve both goals. Have the treat the dry eyes, make the patient comfortable because they don't like the pain points of dry eyes. And how I get to this is if you ask a patient, do you have dry eyes? They don't really know what the symptoms are related to dry eyes. But if you ask them, how do your eyes feel at the end of the day? I mean, I'm asking all of you, how do your eyes feel at the end of a day working on the computer and staring at the screen? Probably not so great. The main thing I hear back is my eyes are tired. And that tired and dry eyes is is it's dry eyes related to staring at a computer because your blink rate slows down by 80%. So you guys know this stuff, but let me just walk you through how I tie everything into beauty. Because again, my goal as an optometrist and clinician is to have my patients follow my directions, and you have to find a way that that resonates with them. So what I start off with first is I will show them the problem. Then we heat up and evacuate clogged tear glands. That's all the rancid oil, the bacteria that's trapped in there. Then we treat the underlying issue, which is the inflammation and rosacea. And then I also do an ochre-based complex, which we debride that really resistant collarettes and crusting along the edge of the lids, and Demodex too. And I use ochre-based. I really want to emphasize that rather than tea tree oil or some of the other detergents out there, because ochre is natural and it's also a moisturizer. And the Dr. Peter Pham, who's the founder of Zocular, he is actually Vietnamese. And when he first introduced me to his line of the ochre-based products for blepharitis, Demodex, meibomian gland dysfunction, I had never heard of it. Now, the National Institute of Health has published a great paper showing that it is more effective and safer than tea tree oil. And patients like it because you don't have to use an anesthetic. It doesn't burn their eyes and whatnot. So how do you get the patient to comply with treatment? First, show them the issue. We use what's called a MyBox, and it's a mybographer. And I will actually image the patient's tear glands to show them how much damage they have already. Because by the time they're symptomatic, they have atrophy or truncation or tortuosity. So it's an unhealthy environment. I show them on the left what example, what their eyes look like. There's loss of meibomian glands. Then you have to compare and show them what does a healthy eye look like. When you combine this by letting the patient know that this is a progressive disease, it gets worse. And even if it's just a little bit, I let them know, if you don't treat this, what's it going to result in? It's going to get worse and worse. Eventually, you won't have enough tears and ability to produce healthy quality of tears to moisturize, nourish, and protect the eyes. And then how does this have, you know, meaning to the patient? You'll lose lashes. Your eyes are going to be red. They're going to be puffy and congested instead of having nice flat waterline. So again, tie it back to the aesthetics of it. So we find out tear glands are clogged. Use heat. You can use heat at home. You can use heat in the office. In the office, we can raise it to higher temperature. Plus, we do the heated massage. There's the MyBothermoflow, and there's also the LipoFlow. Both I've used, love them both. You can see results after the first treatment. And you know what? My practice is in Hollywood, Hollywood, Beverly Hills area. So looking good for my celebrity patients and actors is what they do for a living. So we had patients coming in and using our treatments right before they did a photo shoot or a movie where they do extreme close-up of the eyes. You need to look good. And when you look good, you're actually healthy underneath. So we heat up, evacuate the clogged tear glands. Then the next treatment we normally did was IPL, intense pulse light. What I love about this is it's the missing link for dry eye treatment. It treats the inflammatory root of the dry eyes and restores actually at a cellular level what you cannot restore what's been lost and atrophied, but what you can do is what's left at a cellular level, it can become healthy again and you can see it. It's so great. Patients, I was afraid that patients would not pay for this because we charge at least $500 per treatment on this. But when I said, hey, you know what? There's also an aesthetic side benefit. That means a beauty benefit to this. IPL is also used for fine wrinkles and lines, for sunspots, aging spots, for rosacea, because you're treating the rosacea, which also is on the face. Patients are like, sign me up. They were patients who complained about a $20 copay for their exam or contact lens fitting were willing to pay for this treatment because number one, dry eyes is so uncomfortable. And number two, they want to look better. They want to feel better and look better. So it's a win-win situation for everybody. I always send home homework because yes, I can do a great job in the office and I love seeing my patients. However, if they continue the treatment with homework that I give them, meaning self-care, then they will be better off next year instead of just waiting to see me again. So I let patients know again, if you, because a lot of times we'll assign warm compresses and massaging to patients and lid scrub, but they will do it for a week or so and they stop doing it. But if I remind them, hey, your eyes will feel better, you'll be comfortable working on the computer, less redness, you won't lose lashes, your eyes will be nice and white and the lids will be nice and flat, they are all in. Because I relate this back to, hey, do you put moisturizer on every day? Do you wash your face every day? Yes. Okay. Then I'd like you to do, I'd like you to take care of your eyes every day. So I have them do warm compresses and massage with either an infrared or a heated mask. Then I have, I love this. It's, I don't know if they have it in Vietnam yet, but it is like an electric toothbrush that removes crusting from the edge of the lids. And it is more effective. I mean, as an optometrist, I know what to do, but I still couldn't get off right at the base of my lashes, the collarettes and the crusting. But you can with this device. Then I use ochre based. I want something safe that is effective and also moisturizing instead of drying. And then for the omega oils, omega-3s, instead of using fish oils, I'm using sea buckthorn oil because it has cosmetic benefits. You guessed it. Here's a picture of how that electric toothbrush works. It's called New Lids. It removes the biofilm, bacteria, and Demodex. It reduces inflammation. Oh, by the way, it is great for removing waterproof mascara and eyeliner after you've had your lashes glued on your eyes. And I take it with me whenever I do my modeling photo shoots and whatnot, if I'm out of town, because it really takes it off. Otherwise, the next day, I will wipe my eyes after I've cleaned my lids, and there's still a little bit of black and gray residual, but not when you've used new lids. It also, lots of patients have told me that it restores lash health because it increases circulation to the lids. Great product. Now, I was mentioning, I gave you a little teaser about the sea buckthorn. And this decreases, besides, it's great for improving the quality, tear quality and quantity of tears. It also decreases wrinkles, improves skin elasticity, decreases vaginal dryness and dry mouth. So this is great for your premenopause and your menopausal patients. I mean, who doesn't want, you know, better skin, right? You're treating two things at once. I'm not going to go through this, but I put this up here. So if you get the slides, you can look at the references because everything I talk about is evidence-based. The dry, loose skin and wrinkles. It's, and I'm using it. It's fabulous. Anyways, I want to thank you again for having me here today. I'm going to segue into my associate, Dr. Mark Eltis, and I want to put a plug for our show because we have a show coming up called More Than Meets the Eye. It is health, beauty, lifestyle related. We'd love to have you join us. It's on my YouTube channel, Hollywood Eyes, Dr. Elise Brisco, and I would love to hear from you. Please keep in touch. I'm Hollywood Eyes on Instagram. You can DM me, and on Facebook, I'm Hollywood Eyes, Dr. Elise Brisco. So, cảm ơn quý vị.
Dr. Brisco for this fascinating lecture. And now it's time for our last speaker, Dr. Mark Eltis. With almost 20 years of experience, Dr. Mark Eltis has practiced optometry in New York, California, and Toronto. He's graduated of the University of Waterloo School of Optometry, and he has taught there for over a decade. In 2013, Dr. Eltis was honored as a member of the Optometry Glaucoma Society, having demonstrated excellence in the care of patients with glaucoma through professional education and scientific investigation. Dr. Eltis has been a consultant for academic institutions overseas, contact lens pharmaceutical companies, law firms, and a subject matter expert of for competency evaluations. Dr. Eltis is currently focusing his practice on dry eye patients, employing the latest diagnostic and therapeutic options. He loves connecting with optometry students and the public by sharing his eye care tips on social media. Welcome to Dr. Altis.
Thank you very much for such a great introduction. I hope the music didn't ring in when you were saying that, but let's see if I can control the slide now and start it back. And here we go. So, you know, that music is appropriate because I'm really excited about dry eye. I think it's one of the probably the most underdiagnosed conditions still. And I say that having given my first lecture over a decade ago on the topic and calling it the underdiagnosis and management of dry eye. And I still think it's the case with the aging population, increased screen time and pandemic induced stress, dry eye is a concern worldwide. Now, I'm starting to see it in kids as young as 5 or 6, whereas prior to the pandemic, it was almost unheard of to see it in kids that age. Now, it all begins with warm compresses if we're going to be treating dry eye, whether at home or in office. I'll touch on the in-office a little bit later, but at home, there's a wide variety of products available from microwavable ones to self-heating ones once you open the pack, once you boil in water, and infrared devices, which are great as well, and I know Elise loves. Lid wipes, again, there's a wide variety as well. I try to stay away from the ones that are super soapy and cheap. Definitely baby shampoo is out. We don't want anything like that. It's drying and irritating to the eye. There is tea tree oil options for Demodex, but my favorite right now is Okra Complex products, which are wonderfully safe. They don't irritate the eye and they're very effective. So here's a scientific study that discusses the okra eyelid patch in Demodex blepharitis, and it does eradicate the mites and alleviate the ocular symptoms. It does cause less irritation than tea tree oil, which was one of the main reasons why patients weren't using it. And you'd use it for a couple of months, you'd tell them to switch out to a different wipe, and it was not convenient and it was too much to think about and it hurt. So the Okra Complex patch is great. It's good for sensitive patients, the elderly, kids, but quite honestly, it's good for everybody. I don't know why you would use anything else. And not only does it kill the Demodex, but it decreases inflammation. In terms of in-office procedures, again, you wanna heat the eyelids first, meibomian glands, of course. This allows for easier expression and debridement. And if you're thinking, well, what is that? We're gonna go right into it in 1 second, but what we're targeting is what you see at that bottom of that slide, which is the gunk on the eyelids. So meibomian gland expression, this procedure is comparable to pimple popping. And I get such satisfaction, you know, I was practicing this talk and I was showing one of my friends what I'm about to show you. And she was like, ew, oh my God, I can't handle this. And I'm like, this is what I live for. This is great when I'm doing this in the office and squishing the eyelid and the goo, which is the rancid oil, which should appear more like olive oil, but when it's diseased, it looks like toothpaste, comes out. You can see here, I was using a paddle on these two patients. Now, aside from a paddle, you can also use forceps, which are in this photo, and they're also very effective. Let's see if, I'm not sure if this video is gonna play. Give it one more shot. Oh. There we go, let's see. This is gonna be a treat if it works. Here we go, all right. So I'm gonna narrate. So first you wanna insert the paddle. I don't even use anesthetic a lot of the time unless the patient's flinchy because I wanna know if they're having any discomfort. And then you apply the pressure and here it comes. This is the satisfying moment where meibom is coming out and it's super gross for some people, but boy, is it amazing to see. And the patient does get some instant relief. In terms of pain, again, I liken it to the pimple popping. There is some slight discomfort, but it's very short-lived. Once you stop, then it's gone. And patients do feel really good. You can also warn them, of course, they're gonna be blurry because once the goo comes out, to use technical terminology, obviously that's gonna cloud their vision. Same when you use the heat, that's what happens. The vision can get a little bit blurry. So moving right along to a very long word, microblepharoexfoliation. Don't worry, there won't be a test on it. What that means basically is removing the gunk from the lashes. And one system that you can use is a okra-based system. Again, that's my favorite at the moment. And you are manually cleaning off the gunk in office. Now at home, when someone's using a wipe, they're not really targeting the area. So obviously they can irritate themselves if they go too crazy on this. So with the instruments provided, you can really target the area and reach the skin hair margin, the area where the skin meets the hair follicle, because that's where the majority of the flakes are, the hard to reach ones. And you can see what a difference it makes. If you look on one side, the pre-treatment lashes, and you see the gunk right at the hair skin margin. And then you can see the other picture after the treatment is done. Now, if you're gonna do IPL, which Dr. Brisco discussed, what I suggest is to clean off the lashes first with the okra-based treatment or another comparable treatment. Why? Because if you use IPL, it does kill the Demodex mites, but if they all die simultaneously, there's a inflammatory reaction on the lid. Now, why is that? Because Demodex do not have an anus, so they can't poo. So the feces is accumulated inside their body, all those toxins, and if you use IPL without cleaning the lashes first, all of that mess is gonna be on the lashes and it's gonna irritate the eye. So clean up the patient before you do IPL. Now, another solution other than that okra-based manual system is a mechanical system for heavier deposits. Obviously, it's just like I liken it to a dental cleaning, just like at the dentist, there is like a manual scraper and there's the automated. The automated one has its advantages, and obviously the manual one for more gentle pressure and for patients who tend to be more sensitive. In terms of debridement, this is a low-tech, low-cost procedure, and you get to clean off the debris and the biofilm formations. Again, I liken it to dental cleanings, and I say this is cleaning off the plaque because you don't see a huge amount of stuff, but it makes a big difference because you're cleaning off that irritant off the lashes and off the lid margin, rather, I'm sorry. And it's also helpful prior to the expression so that you remove the clogging that can be present on the lid margin. Here you see a capped meibomian gland or that goo from the inside capping the outside, and it hardens, and so nothing can come out. And so before you do an expression, which is the squishing, you may want to do the debridement, which is the scraping, so you take off that cap. Now, I said scraping, but it really doesn't hurt. Again, I don't freeze most of the patients unless they're flinchy because you don't feel any discomfort when you do it. Just have to be careful not to, obviously, to make them look away so you don't slip and, you know, accidentally injure them. Now, these procedures I like to do in concert and in sequence. So an expression or debridement expression and then okra treatment, which I think also decreases infection because after we do the expression, the squishing, I like the okra-based complex because it's an anti-inflammatory and antibacterial. So it's taking away some of the bacteria on the surface that we've opened things up, decreasing the chance of a complication. Switching gears to some very high-tech solutions for dry eye, low-level light therapy. It uses a principle called photobiomodulation through LEDs or light-emitting diodes of specific wavelengths, and it reduces inflammation and symptoms associated with dry eye. There's different colored filters. To put it simply and quickly, red deals with the inflammation, blue kills off the bacteria, and yellow can stimulate the lymphatic system. You do this for about 20 minutes, and it's, you know, some would argue it's less invasive than IPL or RF, which I'm going to speak about shortly, or even thermal pulsation, which is our next topic. So this is something that Elise touched on. So if there's major clogging inside, remember we did the expression, but if you want a mechanical option for it, then this particular system will heat and squish at the same time. Now, there's also a manual version of this test, and you can see the meibom coming out. So it's heating and squishing, and you can actually see what comes out, which you can't in the one I just showed you. So both of these systems work pretty well. Obviously, the handheld saves space, and some offices that can be a consideration. And you can obviously, the results will vary, rather, I'm sorry, between different patients. but you can get results for up to 12 months. Again, just like a dental cleaning, I go every 3 months. Some people can go every 6 months, and maybe some people go every year, but it depends on the situation. There are some other systems which use heat exclusively without pressure to liquefy the meibomian gland products. And then you can use a expression device, just like I showed you previously, to remove the contents. Lastly, radiofrequency is another meibomian gland treatment. And this comes full circle with what Dr. Elise Brisco was speaking about, because it integrates the dry eye treatment with the beauty aspect. So we're using radio wave energy to heat the glands. And this procedure can soften the meibum and allow for a more effective expression, but it also has beauty benefits or aesthetic benefits to the skin, you know, to remove fine lines, wrinkles, this kind of stuff, make the skin look younger. So some patients will be attracted to that element, but of course, personally, I'm offering it for the dry eye treatment, and the other benefits, if they occur, are just icing on the cake. Also, when you're doing a procedure like radiofrequency, the next thing to do is expression, because remember, we're heating up the meibomian glands, so they're ripe for expressing them right after that procedure. So I hope you enjoyed the talk. I tried to keep it short and sweet so we'd make back time. And I'm always happy to answer your questions. Please follow me on social media. Always happy to hear from all of you guys, Instagram, whatever you like. I'm on all platforms.
Thank you, Dr. Antley. So we finish here our session. Unfortunately, we don't have time for questions. You can find the on-site the speakers during the breaks and lunch, so you can ask them the questions. And our virtual speakers, they gave their social media connections, so you can find them online on social media. Thank you so much for attending, and we will switch to the next session.